and welcome to Boardwars.eu, your bi-weekly podcast about Star Wars, Imperial Assault, a miniature game by Fantasy Flight Games. I'm Stephan, and with me today is Herwig. So, say hello, Herwig.
Hi there, guys.
So, the podcast will be mainly about the game, and then down the road, also about the lore. To get a grip on maybe in this episode on us two, I'll briefly explain how I got to the game and why I'm starting the podcast, and then we'll ask Herwig how he knew about the game or how he got to know about the game. Then we'll go on with the regular topics. My story is I started playing board games seriously not even about a year ago, maybe last summer or so. It's not even a year, and I started playing the Lord of the Rings LCG from Fantasy Flight Games. There is a very famous podcast for this game called Cardboard of the Rings. I listened to it over the months in the fall, and it's a good podcast. They are funny guys. Then I heard about their Gen Con experiences for last year, and they talked briefly about Star Wars Imperial Assault and what it is, and I looked it up on YouTube. There were a few videos about it, and it was really interesting to me because I'm a little Star Wars nerd, I think. So I looked it up and I ordered it from Amazon.co.uk, and I got it, I think, 2 days before Christmas. Didn't end up playing it until January, but I finished my first campaign now, and it's really a good game, but I still got to get a skirmish game going, but more about that later. Yeah, that's probably my story. So we'll ask Herwig how he got to know about the game, and yeah, Herwig, okay, what is your story about Star Wars?
My Star Wars story, well, I think I've always been a huge Star Wars fan, you know. I got back into board gaming like 5 or 6 years ago. Or 5 years ago, probably, I started board gaming again and started with like many serious board games and also listened to a lot of YouTube reviews and podcasts about board gaming. Started to play like Descent, and because it reminded me like of HeroQuest and StarQuest, the games I played as a child. This year, I was like on the Twitter live stream for people who were sitting in the in-flight report of Fantasy Flight, and they were like live tweeting new games and so on, and I really saw like the first pictures and the first news from Gen Con, and decided, yeah, that's something I always wanted to play, because it's like Heroes Quest, it's with Star Wars, and I really knew I had to get that game, and I really looked forward to painting Star Wars minis, so perfect fit for me.
Yeah, that's nice. You also mentioned that you played Descent, and did you play Descent 2nd edition too?
Yeah, 2nd edition mostly.
You played both?
I played 1st edition like only like 2 or 3 nights with some friends who had a lot of stuff for the 1st edition, and then got really into the 2nd edition. Like I think I have all expansions now for Descent 2nd edition.
Wow.
Which are a lot, and we have played 2 campaigns now. And we're in the middle of a third one, and I have to get the people back together, the
band
back together, and yeah, we're also for Star Wars, for the Star Wars campaign, but this will probably be different people, more the Star Wars nerds, and the decent round is with like, more the fantasy nerds, so.
Okay.
2 groups of people.
Yeah, because some of our listeners may not know, because Star Wars Imperial Assault is like a descendant from Descent.
Yeah,
that's a funny sentence to say. It has the base core mechanics on the board, on the table, are very similar.
Yeah,
I think that the main differences between Descent 2nd edition and Star Wars is that Star Wars has the skirmish mode. I don't think Descent 2nd edition has a skirmish mode.
Well, we can discuss about the skirmish mode later, but I think the skirmish mode is mostly here, so it's not a real board game, so they can have it as a miniatures battles game, because they have only the license for the miniatures battle game, not for board games with Star Wars. So I think it's it's the loophole they have.
That's yeah. And I think Hasbro has their license for board games.
Yeah, yeah. There were some
for Star Wars, right?
Yeah, Hasbro has the license, and I think that there were some rumors that Hasbro was behind the delay in December. But probably it was just the wonderful world of international shipping logistics. But they have the loophole with the skirmish mode, and so it's not a straight board game.
Maybe that's the reason, yeah.
But on the other hand, it's just you get two games in one box, which is a pretty sweet deal. So
that's also why I instantly bought it, regardless of its price, because it's for a board game, it's pricey, but it's not that big of a deal if you imagine that you're playing the campaign with maybe three or four friends, and the campaign the campaign out of the box is quite long. We had like seven sessions now, and we played some of the sessions were like 10 hours, and we just finished the first campaign, and it's a really long game. And then on top of that, you have the skirmish mode, and it's a good game for price to value wise. So
like in Descent, the campaign lasts for a couple of nights. So
okay,
I think they are
shorter.
I think, yeah, we had six or seven sessions or something to finish the campaign. But it depends, you know, this system is a lot of things are updated from the last second edition, Descent second edition. So like side quests and so on are handled much more better in Imperial Assault now.
Okay, yeah, we'll come back to that later. Now that we cleared up where Star Wars Imperial Assault comes from Fantasy Flight perspective, because they were also publishing Descent and Second Edition, and Descent Second Edition, so they're basically the third game with this mechanic. We'll go on to our next topic, the news. I think you mentioned it with shipping delays. There was an additional shipping delay in January, I think, because the dock workers union on the U.S. West Coast did a massive strike, and they didn't work, or they hardly worked for about like 6 or 7 weeks, since the Fantasy Flight stuff is manufactured in China. It's shipped over via container cargo ships to the West Coast and then distributed from there. They were quite nervous, and they already had a news article up on the website to explain the delays. But as soon as the article went up, that was about 2 weeks ago, I think, or maybe two and a half weeks ago, they immediately took it down because they heard that the union and the firms employing the workers, they came to agreement. And
yeah, it was
the
just
works...
a couple of hours later, 6 hours later, it was solved, the strike.
And they took down the article, so it's not on the Fantasy Flight website anymore. But you can read about the strike and what went on with the strike everywhere on the internet. It was a big topic in January, so it's hardly to miss. So
yeah.
The main thing that was stuck on the ship were the expansion packs for the base game, because the base games, they were already here, they were shipped in fall, I think, and the expansion packs were after that, and they kind of got stuck on the ship. And the expansion packs, we'll also talk about the expansion packs maybe in a later episode. But if you want to win an expansion pack, you can win it in the podcast. At the end of the podcast, we'll have a lore question about Star Wars related stuff, and you can send us an email with the answer, and you'll be automatically qualified with a right answer, of course, for winning one of the expansion packs. I'll go over about that later. Okay, so that was the first bit of news, and the second bit of news I want to talk about is they also posted a strategy article, Fantasy Flight did, and it's about Vader and how he relates, or how he works in the skirmish game. I think we'll actually postpone it for later in the episode when Herwig will talk about his first skirmish experiences, because it might fit better in there. We'll come to our next topic, and I want to use a little bit of time in the first few episodes, and in the first two or three episodes, to explain how the campaign side of the game works and how to set it up. Because when I got the game, I was quite confused, because there are so many different card decks, and it's hard to get a grip on when to use what deck and what deck does what, and how to set it up to get the first game going. So what I want to do is explain how to set up the first game in this episode, and maybe Herwig, if he doesn't know or does know any additional stuff, or if I make mistakes, he can correct me, whatever.
Yeah.
So what are the different decks for? If you set up a game, the first thing you do is you let the rebel players in the campaign choose their heroes. There are 6 heroes, and they're all quite thematic. You have a Jedi, you have a Wookiee, you have a scoundrel smuggler type, and you have the
army Han Solo type. Yeah.
And you let them choose the heroes, and they have, corresponding to the heroes, they have a rebel class deck, I think it's called. Yeah, that's the right name. And it's like they are small cards. I think they are like 2 inches by 3 or 4 inches large. And the rebel class cards all have the respective hero on their back, so they are easy to pick out and distinguish. And you just give the players their responding hero card. Yeah. That's the large card, and then their respective class cards.
This is like one of the big differences to Descent Second Edition, because there you had like 4 hero classes. You choose a hero corresponding to a class, like healer class, warrior class, rogue, and magic. And then you could choose like a specific deck, like for the warriors, you could be like wolf, beastmaster, marshal, and so on. And I was really surprised that here they went the other way, where like every single hero miniature has their own characteristic class deck. So it's a little bit different way they went here with this game.
Yeah. Also, the heroes themselves, they represent like class mixtures. I think, because you don't have the healer type, or you don't have the tank type. They're all kind of in between there. They are basically made thematic to what their thematic counterparts in the Star Wars universe are capable of. So the Wookiee, he's charging in, and he's brawling all the enemies and cleaving, and when he's wounded, he's going into the rage. So it's more of a thematic link than a gameplay link.
This is something that works here much more better. Like all the, it gives them more character, because they have their own deck of skills, and so the figures gets much more character. In this sense, all of them seem a little bit generic. They're all like heroes, and you can play the same figure as a prophet. You can play him as a disciple, and so on. Yeah. And it's the same miniature, but played with different classes and. You can, as a bard, even, so you're like in the healer class, you even have the bards, and they feel really generic. All the hero miniatures, I have 20 of them, but they lack a little bit of character, and they try to give them some fluff, but this is here solved much more interesting, much more better. So everybody feels like, okay, this is this character, and the other character, every character feels like a character.
It's a nice solution to the problem that players usually want to play a certain role, but to get into a little bit of the Star Wars theme and the feel of the Star Wars universe, you have to cast that role into a character, a real character. And the heroes in the game in Imperial Assault, they are real characters, because they really have abilities that you wouldn't expect from a typical tank, even though they are a tank. So It's a really nice solution. So after the rebels chose each their heroes, you as an Imperial player, the setup, I will always talk from the perspective of the Imperial player. You get to choose your own class, and as an Imperial player, you have 3 different classes, and they only differ in terms of your class cards. They are also like the rebel class cards. These smaller cards, the like 2 by 4 inches cards, and they are easy to distinguish because the rebel cards, all the rebel class cards, all have a rebel symbol on the back, on the top right back, and the Imperial class cards all have an Imperial symbol on the top right back. And they are like, let me count, 2, 4, 6, 8, 9 cards per class. One you get at the start for no experience, and the others you have to buy between the missions with experience. And there are 3 decks. These are Military Might, Subversive Tactics, and the third I never can remember. All right, Technological Superiority. And they also act like themes because they each enhance different parts of your army and how you enhance the troops. Because the first campaign I played was with Military Might, and Military Might basically boosts your stormtroopers to a point where they become massive powerhouses and they can take hits and dish out damage to no end. So it's really funny to play the stormtroopers with this deck. But in my second campaign, I will play Subversive Tactics, and this deck mainly focuses on putting on strain to the heroes and slowing the heroes down. So I don't know how it works out, but we'll see that maybe in a few weeks when I have more experience with that deck. So after the rebels chose their class, you can choose your class. And the rest of the decks, like the unused rebel hero class cards and the unused Imperial class cards, you can just put away in the bag. You can wrap them up with a rubber band and throw them down. You probably won't need them until you finish the campaign. And yeah, you also don't need them in the skirmish, but I think Herwig will talk about that later. So you really, really can play skirmish battles during campaigns without having to divide up cards. So they did a nice thing that yep. In skirmish you only need special skirmish cards, and in campaign you only need special campaign cards aside from deployment cards, which represents your figures, but that's not an issue. So okay, after you chose your deck, you get to construct another deck that's influencing you. It's your agenda deck, and this is basically the things you can buy between the missions with influence you earn. Influence is like the currency of the Imperial player, and the rebels can also buy stuff during the mission between the missions, but they get to you have an upgrade deck, and I'll go back to the upgrade deck in the second episode where I explain how the mission itself works and what to do between the missions. But the upgrade decks are fixed for the rebels, but you can choose your upgrade deck, which is called the agenda deck, by yourself. And these are cards, regular sized cards, and they all have I don't know what the symbol is. It's like a sharded window, I think. It looks Imperial style, and they are easy to distinguish because these are only 21 cards, and they are divided up into 7 sets of 3 cards, each linked together, and you have to choose 6 of these sets to construct a deck of 18 cards. And we expect that in the expansion packs they will be adding additional cards for this agenda deck, also for the Imperial class deck. But we'll see about that when we have the expansion packs on our tables. So you build the agenda deck if you by picking 6 of the 7 different agenda deck types. I think they are called like Lord Vader's Command and Imperial Discipline. They have funny names, and some of them are even linked to missions you can play during the campaign. And you just, for the first campaign, I think you just pick any of the 7 sets and just pick one and leave it out, and you play the others, because without experience, it's hard to tell which are good or which are bad. They also, some of them cost more influence, some of them cost less. You basically want to have many cards that cost 2 influence, because from what I found out, they are the most useful during the campaign, and they are the most useful to buy early and use during the campaign continuously. So maybe that's something you can take away from that. So, and after you build your agenda deck, you usually build the side mission deck for the Rebels, which represents which missions can be played between the story missions. But since you don't actually need to do that before or after the first mission, we'll skip that today and just tell you about how to assemble the first mission that's called Aftermath. And you can postpone the building of the side deck. Really, you can postpone it until after the first mission. By rules, you should do it before, but it's not that big of a deal if you do it afterwards. So, after you build the decks like I told you, you assemble the first mission that's on the, I think it's on the third, on the fourth page of the campaign guide, and it's called Aftermath. And it's consisting of like 10 tiles of the you have, I think it's like 40 or 50 cardboard tiles in the box, and 10 of them you assemble to the first mission and put up the doors and the terminals and the crates and whatever, and then you deploy your units, your starting units, and you have on the page for the mission, you have on the top right you have deployment and setup, and there are three group types listed. First are the initial groups, then the reserved groups, and then the open groups. The initial groups are the ones depicted on the graphic for the mission tiles, the ones that are already standing there at the start of the mission. And the reserved groups are ones you should put aside the minis for them, and you need to take out the deployment cards for them, but you shouldn't tell the Rebels what's coming up, because maybe it's a spoiler or so. And they are deployed after certain events in the mission take place. So you can't deploy them on your own, and you have to wait until you deploy them at least once, and if they are defeated, then you can redeploy them at your command or how you see fit. But before that, you can't deploy them, so you have to kind of wait for the mission to reveal certain enemy types before you can actually play them. And the third group is open groups. These, for the first mission, you can't choose any open groups, but for all subsequent missions, you can choose open groups, and these are just deployment cards you pick out and add to your army, and all these two you can deploy at your will after any round. So after you assemble the maps and put the minifigures on the map and deployed your stuff and laid down your stuff, you also need the threat dial, the threat and round dial. It's the bulky dial thing with two dials, one green and one red. And the red represents your threat, which limits how many troops you can deploy between the rounds. And the right one is the counter for the rounds. And most missions in Imperial Assault, at least in the campaign, have a fixed round limit, after which you basically, most of the time, the Imperial player wins after a certain set of rounds. And the Rebels have to rush to the objectives to come before that, to finish the mission before that. But so this dial is, it's pretty important for you. And then after you set up everything, you read the mission briefing, and that's something I did wrong, like for the first few missions, because the mission briefing, you read the stuff in the box, in the white box, like that's a flavor text about what happens before the mission and what's awaiting the Rebels during the mission. And then you have a list of stuff to read to the Rebels, right? That's usually including what's the active goal or the active target for the Rebels, and like special stuff, how doors open, how they interact with figures, and who can open doors. And after you read that, you're basically set to start the first round, and yeah, you'll do that then and play the first mission. We'll get around talking about how to do the round itself and how to do the post mission cleanup and what to do between the missions in the next episode, to not make this episode too long with explanations that no one's gonna listen anyway. So so that's everything you need to do to set up the first mission and to start playing. And after that, you play the mission and do the post cleanup, and you're basically in the campaign then. With that out of the way, we come to our next point. OK, campaign and skirmish play experience. So since I talked for the last 10 minutes, I'll give over the mic to Herwig, and he'll talk about what he played in the last, I think last week you got your game a week ago
or two weeks ago. Yeah.
I ordered it. And you only played skirmish right now?
Yeah, I managed to get it squeeze in a little game of skirmish and waiting for my players for the
actual campaign. So did you play with the same guy twice or?
Yeah.
So how did it go? Did you win?
I won both times, luckily mostly. And I played Rebels once and once with the Imperials, and it was more or less pure luck. So I think if we both get a little bit more practice, it will even out. I really like the mechanics because for me it was the first time playing with the dice mechanics. I really like how they solved the dice mechanics.
Yeah, with the attacking and defending and the surges and the stuff, right?
And even like if you're a big target, you have other dice than like small agile targets who could dodge or deflect. So that's just really just using different dice makes it much more easier than having like five special rules for everything, you know?
Okay. Yeah, because I think Descent had only one defense die, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Okay.
And in different colors, and everything else were like special rules. So if you're like a stealthy monster or a stealthy target, it was every time it was different rules again. So this is something they really did well.
Yeah, because in Imperial Assault, for those who don't have the game yet, you have two different dice to roll for defend, right? It's like you have one black die and one white die. And black die, usually you have blocks on there that blocks damage. And the black die has more blocks on it, but the white die, it has less blocks overall. But it has one side that's completely evading a full attack, so you evade all damage and all effects from the damage are basically puffing into the air and are non-existent, and that's really good.
It's just a little trick, but it spares the confusion of like having to keep in mind five, six different rules. Although it's like set skirmish game, I think what took for me the most time was setting up the map.
Yeah, I have some shortcuts for that, but I'll talk about that either in the second or the third episode.
We wanted to play a different map then we said it would take forever to find everything. So,
but with a few shortcuts, it's easy to set up the map if you know how the tiles look and how to search for certain.
Yeah,
tiles.
I think that I will probably get faster finding the tiles, and also, I watched a video of before playing skirmish. I watched a video of somebody on YouTube who explained the rules, which helped me a lot. I think if I would have played it without seeing that video, I would have made some mistakes.
So, yeah, there's some complex rules in there, right? Because I made mistakes in basically every campaign mission up until the fifth, sixth, or seventh campaign mission. So it's the fine details that matters, right?
Yeah, sometimes you just like miss a line of text in the rules or something, and
it completely changes what's happening.
Yeah,
right?
and you like. In Descent for a long time I forgot one rule, and that when the heroes are knocked out they also get full strain, it's called stamina in Descent, but they also if they lose all they get also up to full stamina because they're like now knocked out, and I forgot that rule like almost for the whole first campaign, and it made my life as playing the Overlord much more harder
because the
heroes recovered, stood up again, and we're like, carried on.
It's easy for them to just be defeated, but have their
recovering
ready, right?
Strain or stamina is like a key resource for
it's a resource for activating
for the heroes. Yeah,
yeah.
And in Descent there are a lot of missions which are dependent on getting very fast from A to B for the heroes, and they can use the strain or the stamina, sorry for mixing up the vocabulary, but it's basically the same, to get there, like they can waste stamina to move more spaces. So it's very important for them. And yeah,
it's the same in Imperial Assault, where the campaign missions usually, since most missions are timed around base, the rebels have to sprint to the objectives, and one or two tiles extra per round can make such a difference across three or four rounds. And in Imperial Assault also, heroes do that with straining themselves, and you get strain tokens, and you have a limited pool of endurance, and in skirmish you don't, you basically take out all the strain rules, right?
Yeah, you just get wounded more. Wow.
Yeah, you just take damage if you would take strain.
But, you know, taking damages in skirmish, you can take damage, or you can waste some of your, what's it called, command cards?
Yeah, command cards. Yeah. These are the other cards.
Small
that
green
you don't
cards,
use in the campaign, yeah.
You make, like, your own deck of special attacks.
Is it 10
so
cards? Or how many cards do you assemble?
Was it 10 or 15?
Maybe it's 15, yeah.
Something like that. But a fine resource also. You start with, I think, 3 in your hand, and then you draw one per round, and if you control certain points on the map, you can draw additional
cards. Yeah.
So that's also an interesting mechanic. So we will see how it goes in the future and with the expansions, but you have to think about, I have to use not only like a variety of models, because I need some models for area control, some for the objective, maybe need a couple of heroes, but you need, if you want to have like a flexible group for playing, you need like heroes, troopers, everything, you know.
That's also one thing that ties nicely into the strategy article from FFG, because they in the article, someone from Team Covenant, I don't know if you know them, but they have a huge YouTube channel, and they are basically a board game store in the US.
Yeah.
And one of them wrote a strategy article about Darth Vader during skirmish matches. And you have to know about, for the listeners who don't have the game yet, Darth Vader is like the most expensive
figure to
put in the game, right?
But he's really expensive, but he's one of the few models who can attack twice in skirmish if you play like by his rules, and he really like murders people.
The interesting thing is, he's not only he's durable and he's strong, but he's also very expensive, so you don't have that. You have a certain budget of points, and you assemble an army.
It's more or less
with that budget,
half of your army in one model.
And it's one model for half of your budget, so you have less models to move around the map and get to these control points where you can draw additional cards.
If you play with Vader, more or less you have to go for
killing the enemy.
For killing the enemies and knocking them out from the game, because, well, there are various different missions, and with the expansion packs we always will get new skirmish missions, but which I was surprised, like when I first opened the box and I looked through, like for the skirmish missions, there were like only two. Then I realized that two more were in the hero packs that were already in the box. So yeah, so you have now like
I think it's two skirmish missions per hero pack. It's two missions. It's just one
two,
map.
It's one map. On one map, two missions. Yeah.
Yeah, it's one map with two missions on it. Yeah. And so you have basically six free maps and six missions on these three maps.
Yeah.
If you just have the base box.
The guy who explained the rules on the YouTube video for skirmish, he said like maybe he thinks about like printing these maps on paper or something, so it's has them fast assembled.
That's,
so it doesn't
that's also
look
that's also
the
something
tiles.
They are currently discussing on the FFG boards. I think there's a thread where people demanding that not only that FFG puts out PDFs to print with the maps, but also to maybe even make available mats, play mats with printed on maps. That's crazy, right? Because
but it's something they forgot with X-Wing. There's like a like some companies started when X-Wing came up to make different playmats with some stars on it, some nebulas and so on, and everybody bought those because they were, some of them were beautiful, and
I have one too, so.
Yeah, and everybody bought them. And Fantasy Flight came out with some cardboard stuff, which is now gone. They just like printed it once and nobody cared, I think.
Yeah, because it's not practical, right? The mat you can roll together and it doesn't take up much space. And it's still a nice surface to play on. But the cardboard, it's bulky, huge, because the play area, at least in X-Wing, it's like
3x3, yeah.
3x3 feet, and that's too much to store away somewhere, right? And
yeah,
with cardboard.
Yeah, they had it in like little tiles you had to put together, so it was also a little bit flimsy. And in the meantime, several stores online sold nice mats.
Probably they will do play mats for Imperial Assault, but I don't think they will print on maps on that. I think they will, at least for the first year, they will say, bring your tiles. Or
yeah,
have an organizer get like two copies of the game and lay out some maps beforehand. But I think they will hold back on that because they have some pride in their product, I think.
Yeah.
So we'll see how this develops, right?
Yeah, I think maybe they surprise us. Maybe they put out some of these maps, or maybe they put out the PDFs for people to print themselves, whoever wants to print. So
yeah, we'll see. But because in the ally and villain packs, you have it's not only the missions you get. You also have additional cards and additional stuff you have to bolster up your campaign or your skirmish play with. So it's not even about the missions, right? It's about the figures and the
skirmishes,
additional stuff for the mission.
It will get more interesting with the coming expansions, but it's really about like how you build your command deck and which troops you choose for your group.
Yeah, and the skirmish army.
At the moment, it's quite limited. The stuff you can select.
Mm-hmm.
But I think
for the core box, I think it's okay.
Yeah. But for a core box, it's really okay for a core game.
Yeah.
And we will see with the when the expansions finally arrive to Wave 1, how this will change skirmish play. Or
right, Fantasy Flight put out an FAQ recently, and the tournament, the official tournament rules, and in there is something some people really were surprised by, because you have in the core box you have cardboard tokens for some units, right? For some villains or some ally units
and development cards, so you could use them in skirmish.
You could use them in skirmish, but the official tournament rules state that you have to have use the figures, right? And you can only get the figures in the not even yet available expansion pack. So it's a little bit ambiguous right now, because they said with the release of the tournament rules, you basically can play tournaments. But since the packs are not out yet, you can't even build the full army you could build, because you can't use the cardboard tokens. You can only use the figures included in the core box. It's a bit strange, but I think they expected the expansion packs to arrive sooner and not get stuck on the boat that long.
Yeah, I think they were planned for beginning of January, and now everything more or less in Fantasy Flight's schedule is like pushed back 2 months, about 2 months. So I think Star Wars Armada should have been out already, and
wasn't that scheduled for mid 2015? Armada?
No, it's beginning.
Oh, I missed that.
Armada should have come out in February or January. It was scheduled for early first quarter of 2015, but also got stuck on a ship on the boat.
Yeah, that's the famous phrase they use in their articles. That stuff is on the boat, and it was really on the boat for like multiple months, basically.
Yeah.
In this
because
time,
all
in
the
this
ships were waiting in front of the harbor, and
I saw some pictures about that. Yeah, I saw some pictures where I see like 20 cargo ships waiting in front of the harbor, like just 2 or 3 miles off the coast, and not getting into the harbor because no one's unloading the ships already in the harbor. So it's
crazy. Now they have to work overtime to get like all the the surplus load.
I mean, the workers will probably be okay because they get extra overtime pay, right? So they are in a win-win situation. they got like a vacation, and then they have the additional income. So it's kind of working out for them.
Yeah. Yeah, we will see what else gets pushed back or what they manage to get off the boat still in the first quarter. And I think several other stuff will probably have been pushed back thanks to that. So
I'm curious about Armada. That's because I played a little bit of X-Wing, but it didn't grasp me that much because it feels too small for the scale that I want to play at, because it's just a few spaceships against each other, and I like to play with armies. I like to play with armies. So maybe I'll get into Armada later that year, because right now I'm deep into Imperial Assault.
It will just get deeper, because
with the expansion packs, right?
Yeah, during this year we will see. I think they will put out decent amount of expansion, because if you compare it to Descent, that per year one big box expansion, one small box, and like lieutenant packs and monster packs in between, which more or less are the like villain and ally packs, and we will have those in between as different waves. And I think we will see this year at least some kind of small box and one big box expansion.
It's interesting because if they put out another a new expansion before Gen Con, I think they want to do some finals, some worldwide finals for the skirmish mode.
Yeah, they have to put out more figures. Yeah.
Yeah, and if they release expansion packs like big box expansions before they do the finals, are the expansion packs allowed to use in the finals? Because they probably will be right a little bit new at that time, right? Because I can't see them releasing a big expansion box before summer, basically, and Gen Con is somewhere at the end of summer.
It's in August, 15th, 16th of August, around that time, and we will see what they will have. Gamma Trade Show is next week, I think. And sometimes Gamma Trade Show, you get some little news bits out of the Gamma Trade Show. So
maybe they will announce something. Yeah.
Maybe, yeah. And sometimes some podcasters. At the Gamma Trade Shows, they're normally a little bit talky. So sometimes last year they were able to get some stuff out of Christian Peterson even. So he told a little some stuff they will release later that year of the books. So maybe they will talk a little bit, because at New York Comic Con they only showed like a banner of Star Wars Force Within. So they have the license for Force Within, and we will see.
Right?
Yeah, we will see what they do with it. So maybe they will use stuff from Force Within for their current games, or we will see. I think we will see unique games to that universe, to that license.
Yeah, that's. I think expansions covering the new movies, you can basically guarantee that, because it's already in the campaign. You have certain side missions have a time. What's it called? A time, like a timeline limit where
yeah,
you have.
I noticed that.
Where are my missions? I don't know where I have them. Maybe they're here. Yeah, they're here. Let's see about it, because they have some time stuff on that. Where is it?
Yeah, and maybe I can think find you it. Probably can use like most of the technology in Star Wars never advances that far, so that wouldn't be like the big issue. It would only be
they fit together thematically too, right?
Yeah, exactly. You can't play like a young side mission with young Luke Skywalker.
Ah, yeah, here it is. Time period 3 or 4 are all the relevant side missions in the core box are all time period 3 and 4, and I think in the manual they list at least 7 time periods. So it probably goes way up to the new stuff, and maybe even in between that, right?
Yeah, they could really do everything. Yeah, but I think this year we will have the announcement for big box, small box expansions, and like and wave of miniature packs in between. And let's see
it's
if they manage to. Let's see if they manage to get it out before Gen Con something. Like I think wave of miniatures is not that. Miniature way picture miniatures a second wave of some miniatures is I think not that big of a deal production wise.
A big box would be nice before Gen Con, right?
Yeah.
If they plan to release two semi big boxes per year, they have to start early, right?
Yeah. I think without the shipping delay, we already would have some news for that stuff, but
yeah, maybe they're waiting to get the current expansion boxes into the hands of at least some consumers before announcing the next stuff you can buy.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. That normally confuses people or makes them angry.
We'll see. Maybe they'll announce something in the next 2 weeks so we can talk about it in the next episode.
I think in the next 2 weeks some news will happen. Yeah, I'm looking forward if they release like they're starting now with Descent like single campaign books. So that like you only need like the box and how modular the system is. Now that Imperial Assault is even modular than Descent, you can release like just a campaign book with some new main campaign cards, can slide in the side missions, and there you go.
Yeah, it's because the tiles are really flexible, right? The amount of areas you can create is basically limitless. You have, I think it's like 40 or 50 distinct tiles, and they are printed on both sides, so you can mix and match them in endless possibilities. It's really good. It's really well made.
The other thing I wanted to mention before, with many of their other big games, they started like the Quest Vault for Descent. There's like a design your own for scenarios for Battlefront. So I think we'll see something similar for the skirmish game. And maybe then they give people the possibility like that they could print out the map. So I don't know. But we will see like a skirmish generator in one way or other popping out on the page sooner than later, I think. Because they did it for most of their other tournament games, so
yeah, if they wait too long, maybe someone on BoardGameGeek or even the forums is coding it themselves. And because I already saw scans for the tiles are already out there. I mean, Fantasy Flight probably want to suppress that as long as they can, but there's already a vessel. I don't know how to pronounce the program. It's a vessel plugin. You can play the skirmish mode with it. And it seems to work all right. I haven't tried it because
they have to get it out sooner than later because there are people would do it themselves. So I think they are forced to do it themselves.
Yeah, we'll see. That's probably going to happen in the next 4 or 5 months, I think. We'll see how that develops.
But in the meantime, also after Gamma Trade Show, I think before Gen Con, there's also the Star Wars Celebration in May. Which is like the big Star Wars convention in Miami, where they will show the second trailer, and they will show the first episodes of the second season of Star Wars Rebels, and so on.
Yeah, right. And the finals for Rebels was like a few days ago, right?
On Monday, yeah.
Did you watch it?
Yeah.
Because I already watched it, and the kickback to episode one was nice, right?
Yeah.
the final scene or so. I was almost waiting for the other stuff to happen, right?
Yeah.
It was basically the same scene, right?
Yeah. Would be interesting. Some people already asked themselves, maybe we'll see some stuff of Star Wars Rebels creep up in X-Wing, Imperial Assault, wherever. Yeah?
That's also a possibility. Although maybe Rebels is a bit too early for because the time periods, at least for the campaign, the time periods seem to start with New Hope.
It would be older versions of those characters. So.
But maybe they do it like with the Lord of the Rings stuff, where they put out saga boxes that are basically standalone expansions.
I haven't thought about that. That's would be interesting.
You put out a standalone box that's using some of the stuff from the core box, but it's basically, it's from another time, and it's mostly standalone. And they could do the same thing with like a Rebels standalone box that's half the size of the Imperial Assault, includes a few new tiles, maybe a few figures, and then you have a whole new campaign, maybe even replaying the first season of Rebels, which wouldn't be a bad idea, because some of the episodes in Rebels, they basically play like an Imperial Assault campaign mission, right?
Exactly, they're like a group of rebel commandos trying to
do stuff in Imperial
hack a computer
territory
and so on. Yeah,
it's really nice.
Fight against some AT-STs, so they would be already there. So yeah,
that might be a possibility.
Yeah,
but we'll have
didn't think about like the way you could do it like with saga expansions. Yeah, we will see. But I think we have some dates now where they could announce some more stuff. Because normally at Star Wars Celebration, they're like, it's like the mecca for Star Wars nerds. So they have always every year like special edition T-shirts there, and yeah, you name it, all the toys, all the merchandise you can imagine, and they always like to announce special stuff there. So maybe because Fantasy Flights, I think like the role playing game is doing really well. The X-Wing is selling really well. It was the big surprise hit.
X-Wing is like selling crazy.
Yeah, it was like the big surprise hit.
But that might also have to do with the models of X-Wing being
beautiful,
really high quality and really nice to look at.
Compared to like WizKids, like I'm also a big Star Trek fan, and the WizKids stuff the quality is awful, and it's like only nitpicking, but I'm so pissed off that they are not really to scale. Yeah. Like the Enterprise E is like the same size as the Defiant and so on, and it's like it drives me crazy. So sadly I can't, and it's, you can't really, they tried it to modify a little bit, but you can't really play it with these dogfight rules, then playing with the big ships like Enterprise and so on, it doesn't really work. It would be interesting with the, like, there are already out some of the reviews for the Armada rules, and they really tried to capture like the feeling of you commanding a big ship, you know.
Yeah, has much to do with facing and barraging and stuff. I read, right, with the large ships,
and they're like, you know, if you get really on the deep end of board gaming, they're like all these war gaming, and it's like historical war gaming. It's like very realistic, trying to like do naval battles and so on in that part of the hobby, and it gets very like, you feel in the end you're playing like a total mathematical simulation in the one end, or it gets too unrealistic, and it's always hard to find like a balance if you simulate military combat in a way that it doesn't feel too like it's mathematics, or it's too comical, too flimsy, and judging by the first reviews, they found a nice balance. But I think like when they did it with the card game, they really put a lot of time into testing, and for the Star Wars card game, they even started anew, because they had like a first version of it, which was very similar to the Lords of the Ring card game.
Yeah, but just without the you play it against each other, right? Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. I read about that. I was really pissed off.
Yeah, and they scratched that and said no, it doesn't feel right. It just feels like a copy of it, and they did a new version. And
actually, I would very much like to have a copy, basically, of the Lord of the Rings LCG in the Star Wars universe, because there are a lot of Rings LCG. It's relaxed and laid back, and it's deck building, but not too involved, right? You pick your deck, and it can be thematic, but it doesn't have to be. And you play these missions,
and
I would really like to have that in the Star Wars universe.
Fantastic artwork. So the Lord of the Ring LCG is so beautiful,
and it's very thematic, because the cards, most of the time they really reflect what's going on in the reference the card makes, right? So you have like Gimli, who is taking, similar to Garka and Imperial Assault, he's taking damage and then dishing out even more damage because he's getting angry and he's into the fight, and so that they did a nice job with capturing the theme of the characters and the book and the events into the cards. And I would like to have that kind of the same for Star Wars. And I was kind of pissed off that they changed it from a cooperative card game to a versus card game, which I don't like that much because I played some Magic and some Hearthstone, and it's okay, but it's nothing I can get into too deeply because, I don't know, it doesn't interest me.
It's for them really important because they learned that like a good running tournament community can really keep a game alive, even if they don't really buy so much. But if you have like
for many years
standing tournament community, then they like, if a couple of people, they even if they don't buy new stuff, but the fact that they keep playing and talk to other people about this game, they get new people into the game, you know.
Yeah, and the new people will buy all the old packs and so, yeah.
But they announced like this at the American finals, they announced a new model for like cycling through the decks, which is I think similar what Magic does, that only like for like cards, only some cards like from the expansion packs from the cycles, they call
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I heard
are
that,
only
yeah.
Legal for you, like couple of years, but
they phase out stuff that's older, right? So you don't have to have all the whole catalog
exactly,
to be
yeah.
competitive. You only have to have like 3 years, I think. Or 2 years.
And that's manageable if you want to play a tournament. If you just want to play for the fun of it or for collecting, then you can go for it. But
you can go for all, yeah. Like I do with the Lord of the Rings stuff.
But I think we came a little bit off topic, but
that will happen from time to time.
Yeah.
So yeah, let's go on to our next tick on our tick list. We actually have only 4 more topics today, and the next is community stuff, and I want to highlight something happening in the community, either on BGG or FFG boards or somewhere else that's interesting or helpful for running skirmishes, for running campaign or whatever, having to do with Imperial Assault. So the first thing I found out is someone did an automated campaign sheet for Google Docs. I think he started to do it in Excel, but he switched over to Google Docs and he now made it publicly available. It's mostly bug free and you set it up like the normal campaign sheet. It also looks very much like the normal campaign sheet, but you have most of the calculating stuff basically that goes down the drain. You don't have to do it anymore because you put in how many experience the rebels get, and then this is accumulated to a pool, and from then on they can choose cards, and you put in the card, and the cost for the card is automatically deducted from the pool. So you don't rule out any mathematical errors you can make on paper, like maybe I did during your first campaign. So it's also you don't have to strike through the whole campaign sheet sometimes if you're doing the credits calculation, and they get credits and then they buy stuff and then they sell stuff and you strike through numbers all the time. It doesn't look that nice. And so the automated campaign sheet does help with that. And you can try it out yourself. I'll put the link to the Board Game Geek article or forum thread in the show notes. And you can try it out for yourself, basically copy a version of it and use it during your campaign. It's probably really helpful, and I will use it in my second campaign. So maybe I have some experience next time and talk about
that. It sounds very useful, yeah.
Yeah, maybe someone comes out with something similar for the skirmish. I already saw something did a skirmish army builder and deck builder, I think. Did you see it? On board
no, I haven't seen that one, no.
Yeah, maybe I can find it for the next episode.
Yeah.
Let's see. So that's the community stuff for this episode. The next item I wanted to talk is... I'll try to include each week a new rule clarification where there's some rule... There are many rules in the game that are kind of ambiguous or not really that well worded. So I'll try to either to know or to get to know how it works via BoardGameGeek or the FFG forums, or I'll just mail to FFG and wait for a reply from them. And for the first card I want to talk about, it's from the Imperial class deck Military Might. You have the card Endless Ranks, and it reads, when I can find it, when you deploy a trooper, reduce its deployment cost by one. So you have to know about how to deploy figures, and normally, like stormtroopers, which have the trooper trait, cost, I think, 6 threat, and this card lowers the threat you need to expend to put these 3 miniatures on the board to 5. But it was unclear if that also takes place when you just reinforce the group, because each turn, if one of the stormtroopers is still alive and you have 2 threat, you can reinforce the group with 1 additional stormtrooper. They can never be more than 3 per group, but if you have just 1 or 2, you can expend 2 threat and put another stormtrooper in the game. And it wasn't clear if that deduction also takes place during reinforcement, and the answer is it doesn't. So you still pay the whole 2 threat, or for the elite counterpart you pay 3 threat for an additional board figure on the board. And the next clarification about this card is that this deduction also doesn't accumulate over the game. So if you put a stormtrooper group on the board for 5 threat and they all get defeated, the card you have in your hand, you returning the card to your hand, you can play it again, but the card returning to your hand, it doesn't carry over this deduction. So you don't have to, you can't apply the deduction again to reduce the cost to 4 threat, but it's still costing 5 threat. And I think it's a problem with that card, because the card is not that good if you consider how much it costs, because it costs 2 experience, which isn't that, it's not that much, because the most expensive cards cost 4 experience, but for 2 experience you get a deduction of threat for 1 for all your stormtroopers, but it doesn't impact the game that much. I think I played it in my first campaign and I did use it, and it did come in helpful maybe once or twice, where I had exactly that amount of threat, and I was able to play the stormtroopers. But I don't know, it's kind of a lackluster card if it doesn't have any additional synergy with stormtroopers or with playing it again. So yeah, so the basic gist of it is the card only works once, and it only reduces the threat you have to pay for troopers, so like stormtroopers or EVAP engineers, by 1. And it's not a good card, I think. Herwig, you still here?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay, so you were silent during all of that.
Yeah. But I think the only problem I have heard that some people had with the rules was that the wording sometimes for some campaign missions about being wounded and damaged was not really clear. Like some people mistook like having some damage on their character for not being able, because I think it's meant by wounded if you flip the hero sheet over. Yeah.
Also not corrected in the FAQ, but I think it's worded consistently throughout the manuals. But you have to take care, because damage on your card doesn't mean you're wounded. Wounded is only if you take damage equal to your health, and then you have to flip over the card to the wounded side. It's called wounded in the manual, so maybe that's confusing people.
Yeah, I think if people get more used to this mechanic, they understand it better, because here in this game it takes a long time to knock out a hero, yeah, and it's a little bit different mechanic to the mechanic of from Descent and the other games.
That's also what I found out during my campaign. It's sometimes it's really hard to hurt or really wound the wound the rebel players, especially if you don't play with four rebel figures, but with just three or two rebel figures, because in that case they also get an additional health boost, and it's making them even more resilient. I don't know, but some missions are even harder with less figures. Oh, maybe we'll talk about it in the third or fourth episode. Let's hear about that. So that's the rule clarification for this week, and that brings us to the second last topic. The raffle for this episode. You can win an IG-88 villain pack in the first episode. The only thing you have to do is answer the following question to our and mail us with the answer. And the question is, who was the captain of General Thrawn's flagship Chimera? I think I don't know if I spelled that correctly. I did listen to the audiobook of that particular book a few weeks ago, and I think they said Chimera. People who know the answer will probably know what I'm talking about. People who don't know the answer probably can Google it, because it's a really easy question. Yeah. So if you want to win the pack, think of the answer, put it in an email, and send it to podcast@boardwars.eu. podcast@boardwars.eu. No dashes, no other points. It's just podcast@boardwars.eu. So yeah, Do that to maybe win an IG-88 villain pack. Of course, that only happens when they're finally out. Yeah. And to qualify, you have to either be somewhere in the US or somewhere in Europe where I can actually send it to you. Not that I have to send it to Australia or something else. That's it for the show, I think. At least for the first episode. We also we did good on time. It's about an hour or so. So I think we covered a lot of topics, a lot of good topics. Our tangent was didn't went that far off. So it wasn't a success in that right. And if you want to contact us, you can find us either on the website www.boardwars.eu or just boardwars.eu. We can also be reached on Facebook. I have a Facebook page that I'll put the link to it in the show notes. And of course, you can write to podcast@boardwars.eu and also reach me directly with Stefan with PH at boardwars.eu. I will also put all of this in the show notes for your convenience. So Perfect. That's it for this episode. Herwig, any last comments?
No, I'm fine with this.
You're fine. Okay, then we'll see each other in 2 weeks, and maybe the packs are out then. If not, yeah.
I really hope so. I'm really looking forward.
We'll have to talk about other things then. So we'll see about it.
I want to paint a Han Solo.
Yeah, we'll see about that in 2 weeks. Maybe we'll talk about painting then. Okay, that's it for this show. See you in 2 weeks.